Okay, thanks, Spencer. So this is a lecture in our African Worlds lecture series this semester. And we had last week Dr. Sifiso Ntlovu from South Africa, so hopefully you're not tired of hearing from me. Next week we'll have a Mozambican author who will be speaking at 11, the same room, and then we'll have one more talk after that. Today I am very happy to have Dr. Peter Leman here to introduce to you. He came to BYU last year, 2011, and this is his second year at BYU. We were just delighted to hear that he was coming to join the English department because of his expertise in African literature. He finished his PhD at UC Irvine, where he studied and now he teaches 20th and 21st century British and post-colonial literatures. His research deals with the intersection of African literature, the law, and oral literature or performance. So very interesting topics that he will be talking to us about. And this has to do with his former advisor, who is a very famous African author from Kenya, Ngugi wa Thiong'o. I just was recently reading about some of the community theater programs that Ngugi wa Thiong'o was involved in. And Dr. Leman touches on some of these aspects of how people or how Africans were shaping their societies during the end of the colonial period and after colonialism through engaging politics, the law, and through literature and orature or oral literature and performance. So his current book project looks at East African literature and orature in general. Well, he focuses on a few authors and people in the context of this colonial and post-colonial legal history. So I think we'll be introduced to a number of very important aspects and interesting issues that he deals with in African literature. To give you a sense of his work, I want to read a few of his titles of his publications, which I think are very intriguing and show how his work deals with some very interesting issues that are practical as well with literature. So, for example, African Oral Law and the Critique of Colonial Modernity in the Trial of Jomo Kenyatta is one of his more recent articles, Singing the Law. A very interesting title there, and I'm going to, is it Okot Bipetek? Is that Bipetek? Okay, how you pronounce that. Legal Imagination and the Poetics of Traditional Justice. Also, The Political Conditions of Contemporary African Fiction, dealing with China as well, and Speaking with Authority, The Forms and Ideas of Justice in African Oral Culture. So we're very grateful to have Dr. Leman here to help us learn more about African societies through literature and the law. Thanks.
Good morning. Thank you very much, Leslie, for that introduction. And I want to thank Leslie and Rex as well for organizing this lecture series and giving me a chance to be a part of it. And thanks also to Corey Leonard, Jeff Ringer, and the Kennedy Center for hosting this and making these lectures possible. I want to begin my talk with a brief story. Some of you may be familiar with the Somali novelist Nuruddin Farah, pictured here. Farah is one of the most important writers in Africa today and is best known perhaps for his novel trilogies. He likes to write these lengthy trilogies of novels, one of which I'll talk about shortly. But Farah grew up in the Ogaden region of western Somalia. Which is an area that has been at the center of long-standing disputes between Ethiopia and Somalia. Of course, Somalia is on that the northern, northeastern horn there, and then the Ogaden is this area between Ethiopia and Somalia. And officially, it's part of Ethiopia, but it's been an area of significant dispute over the years. But Farah grew up there, and when he was 12, a friend of Farah's father came to him and asked him to write a letter. Farah had been to school, was well-educated, and was a valued scribe in a region where most people couldn't read or write. This friend of his father's had a problem. His wife had left him because he beat her, and he needed Farah to write a letter so that she would come back. Farah listened attentively as the man dictated and asserted that he was within his rights to behave as he did, and further that if she refused to return, he would track her down, bring her home by force, and beat her again. Not particularly persuasive. The wife had indicated her intention to file for divorce, but the husband insisted that this was impossible. It was then that Farah, as a scribe, as translator of the oral to the written word, made a very interesting and morally complex choice. He changed the letter. Rather than writing the husband's threats, Farah secretly and quietly, quote, made him say that if she did not come back within a few days of receiving the letter, or if she continued raising objections against being beaten by her legal husband, then there was nothing left for him but to divorce her as she requested. So Farah wisely had the husband leave his thumbprint on the letter, giving it his full approval and absolving the writer from any responsibility for its contents. Farah later learned the outcome of his choice. The woman assumed that she was divorced and she remarried, and when her previous husband found out about this, a dispute arose and it went to court. Farah recalls that the letter he'd written during the trial was produced, and the Islamic judge, after reading the letter, decreed that the woman was legally the wife of her current husband and that the previous husband had no claims. Farah was very happy about this. He was very pleased with the outcome, but his father's response was less clear. Farah recalled, "I could not determine from the expression on my father's face if he were proud of me or ashamed, but he was clearly disturbed by my wily ways, as he put it, forbidding me henceforth to write letters on behalf of others." So I share this anecdote at the outset here because it introduces, I think, some of the issues that I want to discuss in addressing the topic of law in African literature. First, I think it's just amusing, but it also foreshadows some of the concerns that Farah's later work takes up, namely women's, the relationship between orality and literacy, the role of Islamic law in Somali society, women's rights, and the question of the artist's role in speaking for the oppressed, speaking against oppression. What interests me most, of course, is the way in which literature in this incident, in the form of the letter, and fiction, in the form of the fabricated details, take on significant legal status in this effort to protect the oppressed woman. Furthermore, the tension in the story between orality and literacy is also a tension with significant legal implications, as I will explain over the course of this talk. So in this presentation, I want to introduce you to the field of law and African literature generally, using Somalia as a primary case study. Somalia is a fascinating and complex country that unfortunately is sort of better known in the West today as a failed state, as a haven of pirates, as a place where Al-Shabaab, which the militant group that's had connections to Al-Qaeda, is functioning. As is always the case, however, there's much more to Somalia than those sensational details that get emphasized in the media. For example, Somalia has an extremely rich and lengthy literary tradition, and it was once known popularly as a nation of poets. And what I want to talk about today is not just that Somalia is a nation of poets, but that from a certain perspective, to say that Somalia is a nation of poets is also to say that Somalia is a nation of lawyers. Which that may sound kind of hideous to the Western ear, a nation full of lawyers, but it'll make sense. Sophia McLennan and Joseph Slaughter, in a special issue on literature and human rights in the journal Comparative Literature, emphasize the need to focus on literary and cultural forms in discussing human rights because, they say, much of the imaginative and social work that literature does is done over time and space and is done through the forms of stories that enable forms of thought, forms of commitment, forms of being, and forms of justice. The forms of Somali oral and written literature are unique in their ability to enable such forms of thought, commitment, being, and justice, and provide one of the more interesting examples of the intersections between law and literature in Africa today. Before I say more about this, so I think maybe it would be helpful to give a little bit of an introduction to law and literature as a field before going into law and African literature. So I hope most of you have heard of the field law and literature. It's the kind of self-explanatory, I guess. It's an interdisciplinary field that explores the variety of ways in which the discourses and practices of the law can intersect with and interact with those of literature. There were scholars looking at legal themes in Shakespeare's works in the early part of the 20th century in a scattered way. Even the famous legal scholar and Supreme Court Justice Benjamin Cardozo wrote about law and literature in 1925. But by most accounts, the movement, as it's known today, the field of law and literature, began in the 1970s when a scholar named James Boyd White published a book called The Legal Imagination. and several subsequent studies in which he claims that judges are poets, that legal texts can be read alongside works of fiction and poetry as literature, and that literary study should be introduced into law schools and legal education. White's work was followed by many others in the 1980s and 90s. A few pictured here. Richard Weisberg has been a major figure in the field. Richard Posner, the law and economics scholar at University of Chicago, wrote this very sort of scathing critique of law and literature. It was sort of threatening to his law and economics field. And a few others here. So White's work was followed by these and other works in the 80s and 90s as scholars began to explore the range of ways in which law and literature intersect, driven by different motivations. In some cases, legal scholars believe that the technical approach is primarily sort of embodied by the law and economics movement, according to some accounts anyway, that those technical approaches could be humanized through attention to literature. And literary scholars believe that literary studies could find a way of being relevant to the real world through law, through attention to law. And others simply found that reading one discipline in the context of the other would produce perspectives that just wouldn't be available otherwise, that you can tell stories about literature and culture through these intersections that we couldn't tell otherwise. Early on, most approaches to law and literature fell into one of two basic approaches, examinations of law in literature, in other words, looking at texts with legal themes or that contain representations of law in some sense. Herman Melville's Billy Budd is sort of the most famous kind of core text in law and literature studies, The Merchant of Venice, Kafka's The Trial, texts such as this. The second approach examines law as literature, which includes approaches that apply literary theory or rhetorical analysis to legal texts. In recent years, there's been an increasing amount of attention paid to law or literature in law, in other words, the ways in which law regulates and responds to literary texts in the form of copyright, censorship, intellectual property. And much less scholarship, although there's more, has focused on the question of literature as law. Can cultural forms such as literature assume the force of law in any sense? Or as the literary critic J. Hillis Miller once asked, can a work of literature lay down the law? This is an intriguing question, and one that I think many of us coming from the literary side of things would like to answer in the affirmative. Yes, it can lay down the law. But typically, no, it doesn't. It can take up legal themes or even make the law, disturb the law by doing something offensive or illegal, but it doesn't typically lay down the law or take on that force of law. But in some cases, it can. It's difficult to imagine in Western contexts, but in certain African societies, it actually kind of goes without saying that cultural forms have the force of law. And this is one of the reasons why law and literature, I argue at least, is law and literature in Africa, I argue, is such an important field. So law and literature approaches to Africa have been relatively recent. It's a relatively recent phenomenon. The geographic focus of law and literature was quite narrow for many years, with most scholarship focusing on England and the US. There were a few exceptions, but not until the last few years have scholars started looking at non-Western contexts, including Africa. In his groundbreaking 2008 book, for example, Legal Oppositional Narrative, A Case Study in Cameroon, Stephen Bishop argues that there are rich and pervasive intersections between law and literature in Africa, where law constitutes a much more freely interpretive text than in the West, and where literature shows a greater concern and engagement with the law. One of the reasons that this is so is because many African societies have extremely rich oral traditions, and therefore the practical expression of traditional law is itself oral. This is kind of a straightforward observation. The law would be oral if there isn't a written medium. But this has significant implications. This means that the boundaries between law and other forms of cultural expression, art, education, religion, things that we've labored to make distinct in Western societies are blurred or non-existent in many traditional African societies. Legal concepts are inscribed in oral expressions, poetry, myths, songs, proverbs, riddles, rituals, and other symbolic practices. So orature, as Leslie said, meaning oral literature and performance, archives law in this sense, kind of providing a body of legal wisdom and precedent that is drawn upon when a community is faced with disputes or other legal matters. So for example, if a dispute comes up between two parties over some issue, a traditional court would convene where, you know, maybe a council of elders would sit down and mediate the discussion, and the different parties would have the opportunity to present their case, And those councils of elders would oversee this and would draw upon stories, myths, proverbs to recommend courses of action, to kind of insert principles of wisdom to follow to help make a decision. The Ugandan poet Okot Batek, who was both a trained lawyer and a legal ethnographer, takes this a step further, claiming that because poets and singers are those best in oral traditions, they are both the society's entertainers and its legislators. He writes, "The African artist proclaims the laws, but expresses them in the most indirect language. Through metaphor and symbol, in image and fable, he sings and dances his laws." And he meant this in a very literal sense. Thus, orature is not only an archive of law, but also a legal practice. Orature is as much performance and procedure as it is substance and content, and is central to traditional legal procedures. Somalia offers a particularly interesting example of this. As I noted before, they have a very rich and sophisticated oral tradition, and orature in Somali, traditional kind of pastoral rural Somali society, plays a very significant socio-political and socio-legal and not simply aesthetic role. Eloquence and oratory is one of the most highly valued abilities in Somalia, even in urbanized areas. When Richard Burton traveled to Ethiopia in the 1850s, to Somalia, he observed that the country teems with poets, and it was Canadian novelist Margaret Lawrence who called Somalia a nation of poets. More recently, Said Samader has said, "When they talk of poetry, Somalis have in mind something which embodies the totality of their culture and to which they attach the highest measure of importance. In the words of one elder, poetry is the central integrating principle without which harmonious relationships in society would be unthinkable." The elder whom Samader quotes here doesn't state it explicitly, but when he refers to the necessity of poetry in maintaining harmonious relationships, he's talking in part about the central role of poetry in customary law, or heer, spelled X-E-E-R, heer law. Poetry serves a variety of functions in Somali society, but it has a particularly significant place in shaping the procedures of customary law. Within the Somali clan system, large-scale decisions are made and disputes resolved through lengthy public consultations, during which various parties can present their ideas and perspectives to those designated to weigh options and recommend courses of action. And those individuals who've proven their superior abilities as poets are favored participants in legal disputes. In fact, according to the scholar Ali Jamali Ahmed, the best lawyer a plaintiff or an accused could have is a good poet. I like that. I think that's, can you imagine, you know, you're being sued and you're like, I need a lawyer. So instead of looking up lawyer, you go to the English department. Okay, where are the poets? Can I, Lance Larson, come and help me out. It would be interesting. In a heer or a customary law assembly, there are three types of men who dominate the meeting: the orator, the poet, and the expert in tradition, called the heerbigti. There are typically orator-poet pairs on each side of a dispute, acting as advocates. The orator speaks first, presenting a case, and then he gives the floor to the poet, who covers the same ground but in poetic oration, repeats the same arguments but in poetic form. And the heerbigti, who are usually elders with a proven knowledge of precedent and tradition, as well as exceptional skill in oration, listen to the presentations and deliberate not only on the basis of the substantive merits of each case, but also their aesthetic merits. A heer assembly is a battle of wits and words, and for success in the battle, Samader writes, not only is knowledge of history, customs, and tradition essential, but also the ability to articulate them into a coherent whole is equally, if not more, indispensable. For although they do not concede it in so many words, Somalis tend to emphasize style over substance in resolving litigation, so that the skill with which a case is presented seems to carry greater weight than its actual merits. Thus, poets are not simply voices of morality and wisdom, but their poetry and skill with words and oral performance play a fundamental constitutive role in traditional legal procedures. Furthermore, the interconnectedness of orature and law is such that, according to Ali Musa Iye, there is an entire corpus of oral literature that he calls the literature of heer. So not only do orators and poets use literary techniques in presenting their cases, but because of poetry's role in legal procedures and the sort of crossover between literature and law, there are poems, proverbs, and prose texts of different kinds dealing directly with heer-related themes. EA conducted interviews with a number of Somali elders and poets in northwestern Somalia in an effort to collect heer literature, but he said it was difficult because often they couldn't really distinguish between what was law and what was literature, because they overlapped so much. as an example, here's a translation of one of the poems that he recorded, which is basically a judge's prologue, a Hirbigti's prologue at the beginning of a case. One convenes, the other presents the case. One opens the meeting, the other explains the facts. One presides and the other decides. One loses and one wins. The case is discussed by those who have faith, without intrigue and without ulterior motives. Hear those who have ears, see those who have eyes. When the testimonies are taken, when the oaths are taken, let the reporters report. Let the experts evaluate. Let the arbitrators supervise. And may the just watch over the law. Against amalgams and failures, against the biased and ignorant, against liars and the corrupt, always separate before taking a decision. Facts due to the concurrence of circumstances and those due to human malevolence. The judgment of the dead is left to God. The living is the business of the old. And if you were to read this in Somali, you would see a number of poetic techniques that they use. And instead of rhyming words in Somali, they rely heavily on alliteration. And there have been these kind of poetic duels, these kind of historic events where poets will come and compete in these duels to see who can come up with the best alliterated poems. And there was one called the Dili poetic duel some years ago where all the poems had to alliterate the letter D. It's really interesting how they're able to do this. Now, just because orature is law, this does not necessarily mean that orature is also equivalent to justice. In Okot Batek's writings, Gugi Wathiongo's writings, and others, they see an orature has this very sort of liberatory potential, this potential for resistance and imagining new forms of justice. But one of the refrains of Somali poetry, and one of the reasons I think it's such an interesting case, is that it emphasizes the fact that orality can be used for both just and unjust purposes. As one poet put it, in a poem called I Am, the bitter-tasting aloe sometimes shoots forth flowers, and you can drink its sweet nectar. I am both sweet and bitter-tasting. My right and left hands are twins. One gives succor to travelers and to the weak, and the other one is sharp knives. So while skill in poetry can bring honor to the poet and his clan and can be used to persuade others toward justice and fairness, the same skill can be used to attack others and bring about evil and injustice. Saitse Mader identifies four types of orators, three of which are classed according to their skill. The first is the afmal, which means literally mouth wealth, or the speaker whose words are like wealth, which is the most skilled orator of towering prestige who has the reputation of never having lost a case in which he's argued. The second is aftahan, which means mouth generous, or the speaker who lacks prestige, the prestige of the afmal, but who's still pretty good, commands some respect for his first skill, right? The fourth category, and I'll come back to the third as he lists them anyway, is the afgaru, which means mouth deformed, or the speaker who has absolutely no oratorical skill whatsoever. The afgaru is hashisha madasade, or he who cannot defend his camel. So the third orator is called the afmashar. There we go. And has skill comparable to the first two types, a high level of skill, but it is used for negative and destructive purposes. Literally meaning mouth saw, the afmashar is the man of universal scandal and provocation, trafficking in malice and insidious rumors and inciting clans to feud. The afmashar's vocabulary is drawn from the bitter-tasting dimensions of Somali orature. He has powerful instruments for persuasion, states a Somali elder, but always uses them to create mayhem. Significantly, while afmashars have played a role in rural Somali society, urbanization and modernization have played have in the last several decades appear to have created a new niche in which the mouth saw poets flourished. Reviled and feared in rural Somalia, the afmashar became a commodity in the politics-driven environment of the city. With the erosion of collective kinship accountability in traditional society, afmashars exploited the impersonal society of the city and began in particular to lend their services as propagandists and public relations men to politicians. As Sumater explains, afmashars demonstrated unprincipled readiness to sell their talents to the highest bidder. And nowhere was this more obvious than in their intimate attachment to the powerful in the politics of pre- and post-independence Somalia. Somalia received its independence in 1960. It had been colonized by both Britain and Italy, and it's a long, very complicated story. but official independence in 1960, and there were several tumultuous years up until 1969, when General Siad Barre staged a coup and took control of the nation, offering progress through a system of what he called scientific socialism. The path from Barre's promising early years to his overthrow in 1991 is long and complex as well, but suffice it to say that he became a classic neo-colonial dictator, a figure that has plagued many African nations in the post-independence period. Interestingly, one of the methods that Barre used to garner support for his rule early on was to promote his ideas throughout his regime through orature. Barre was reputedly versed in the poetry and oral tradition for which the Somali people are justly famed, and he was an accomplished orator himself. Furthermore, in the early years of his regime, Barre managed to lure the support of many oral poets to his cause. The traditional intellectual or artist gave moral and intellectual justifications for his rule. In other words, Barre employed afmishars, those gifted in language who were willing to sell those skills to the highest bidder. Poets and artists fought against Barre's regime as well, and given the power of the spoken word in Somali society, it's no surprise that poets were and continued to be targeted by those in power. This was extremely sad. This was in the news just 2 days ago, I think. I don't know if you saw this, but Warsame Shire Awale was one of Somalia's most famous contemporary poets, playwrights, and he was killed. He was gunned down by the militant group Al-Shabaab for writing and performing radio plays that were critical of the Al-Shabaab group. So oral art continues to be a very powerful and provocative medium in Somalia today. During Siad Barre's regime, the novelist Nurun Farah, to come back to him finally, began writing a trilogy of novels aimed at providing an alternative to Barre's propaganda. And he states this explicitly, that his purpose was to counter the propagandistic discourses of Barre's regime. The trilogy, collectively titled Variations on the Theme of an African Dictatorship, is based on Barre's regime. In the novels, his fictional avatar is named simply the General. And although Farah's a novelist, this trilogy draws heavily upon oral traditions, and in particular is conscious of this sweet and bitter-tasting dimensions of orature. And in fact, the title of the first novel, Sweet and Sour Milk, gestures toward this very issue of orature's duality. Sweet on the one hand, capable of promoting justice and attacking injustice. Sour on the other, able to stir up malice and suspicion, to propagandize and sing the praises of that which is unjust. However, not only is Barre or the General able to appropriate orality for unjust purposes, but he also mobilizes the other side of the oral performance, orality or listening, in order to attain complete control over the Somali soundscape. Barre was an excellent orator, but particularly through the ears of his National Security Service, he was also an excellent listener, attuned to voices of dissent, and ready to employ both modern and traditional forms of law to suspend those voices. So in an environment like this, how is resistance possible? What role can the sweet or just dimensions of orature play when the conditions for democratic performance are severely restricted or controlled? Does writing become the favored mode of resistance, or can orature adapt further to undermine its own misuse? And if Somali orature is law, can a work that appropriates those oral traditions offer an alternative form of law? Can it lay down the law in some sense in response to the oppressive laws of the state? I don't have time to give a full reading of Farah's trilogy, but I'll just give kind of a brief outline of how this perspective might be applied to his texts and how his novels might provide some interesting responses to these questions. So Farah's novels, formally and thematically, are very ambiguous, never delivering singular or didactic imperatives. They have very complex and multidimensional characters. They aren't mythical heroes, in other words, which one might expect in narratives whose aim is to resist the propagandistic, oppressive narratives of a dictator. But it's this very ambiguity and complexity that made the novels effective in countering Barre's unchallengeable truth. Another of Somalia's famous poets, Muhammad Ibrahim Warsame, popularly known as Hadrawi, talked about this, and he said that Barre's monopolization of public poetry and media in promoting himself was foreign and incongruous. He said this was he said people were not accustomed to a dictation culture, to being told that in a very sort of singular way that this is how things are, this is how things should be. They weren't accustomed to this. And Farah's novels use a very diffuse polyphonic and dialogic form that turns away from Barre's dictation culture toward a sort of postmodern African culture in which the egalitarian openness of the procedures and poetics of here law intertwine with the written word, with challenging perspectives on gender and with a deep skepticism for any line of thinking or worldview that verges on the dogmatic. As Dirye, the main character in the third novel, states, it is the prerogative of God alone to be sure of anything. So in the longer reading of these novels, I trace the kind of movement and trajectory of positive forms of orality throughout the trilogy as they're negotiating with the negative forms, noting Oricher's role in the exploratory and counter-dogmatic processes of challenging the general's regime. By banning public gatherings and extending his aural or listening range throughout the nation, the general threatens the ability of like-minded individuals to communicate, gather, organize, and resist. In the first novel, Sweet and Sour Milk, the initial defense in the face of the general's domination, kind of complete domination of the soundscape, is to remain silent and to preserve the sort of potential energy of orature in memory. In Sardines, the second novel, the opportunity for the revolutionary possibilities of orature and orality emerge as technology in the form of cassette recordings. This was in the 80s. Cassette recordings of subversive poems allow the formation of an imagined community by bringing like-minded individuals together across vast spaces otherwise inhabited by the voice of the general. And the cassette culture was kind of vibrant and thriving in Somalia. And Barre himself is said to have amassed a huge collection of these poems, where people would record subversive poems and pass them on, and you could hide it and then listen to it in secret. And people would gather it at people's houses and listen to these poems. And it sort of, in the novel, it allows this sort of growth of this movement, people to come together and resist the general. In Sardines, Derek Wright argues the cassette becomes the oral tradition's answer to the debased oral techniques that help keep the general in power. The third novel in the trilogy confirms that the underground movement has grown in strength from the strategic silence of Sweet and Sour Milk to the community building technology-based orality of Sardines. In Closed Sesame, the third novel, we find dissenters who are prepared finally to perform an act of founding violence, as Jacques Derrida calls it, able to present itself as having a right to law. There has been no shortage of law throughout the trilogy, nor a shortage of orality, but so often law and orature have appeared in the bitter-tasting form articulated by the dictator. In Closed Sesame, the authority of orature achieves a level of strength unseen in the previous novels, buttressed by figures of law who seek to vindicate justice by eliminating the general. I've thought it's curious, the names of these novels are interesting, and Closed Sesame, I mean, Open Sesame is that magic word that opens something. It has the kind of the performative power of a speech act, right? Which, I mean, many of the classic speech acts are in law. And so Closed Sesame, this idea of kind of closing the door, shutting down the dictator through orality that has the force of law is sort of invoked in that title. So the main character in particular, Dirye, whom I quoted before, who's an aged patriarch and a former anti-colonial fighter, he finds inspiration in both the normative values of Islam and in Somali oral poetry. And the third novel is very explicitly concerned with the law, and we see law through all three of the novels. In the first novel, we hear the general say, "I am the Constitution," and these themes kind of continue, but it comes out most explicitly in the third novel. And several of the main characters, including Dirye's son, are legal professionals who are seeking to find some legal justification for ousting the general. And I won't spoil the ending for you. I encourage you to read Farah's novels. They're quite fascinating. But given the complex ways in which orature and law intersect in Somali culture, and given Farah's use of oral conventions and the explicit themes about law in his texts, I think his novels offer a unique case study for law and literature approaches to Africa. And I think they can be read as having legal significance in some sense. And it's not coincidental that Farah was forced into exile for what he wrote. The Kenyan novelist Ngugi wa Thiong'o writes that the traditional African artist and the state are rivals in articulating and disseminating the law. And I think this is what happened in Farah's case, where the state recognized a powerful rival in Farah. And in the many poets, other poets and artists who utilize the power of poetry to imagine new forms of law and justice. And ultimately, I think this is one of the things that law and African literature can offer, unique perspectives on questions of law and on human rights. To return to what I quoted before from Sophia McLennan and Joseph Slaughter, much of the imaginative and social work that literature does is done through the forms of stories that enable forms of thought, forms of commitment, forms of being, and forms of justice. And it's such forms of thought and justice that Somali orature and literature enable when we recognize this essential relationship to law. Thank you.
I want to thank Peter for that great and enlightening talk. We have some time for questions. So we'll open it up for questions. If you have a question, please wait for the microphone to get to you. We're recording this, and so then people who are listening to it or watching this later can then get that. So the microphone is back there. So I have a question, then we'll open it up. Okay.
My question has to do with kind of the perception of writing. Is written culture always a colonial culture in this context?
No, I don't think so. I mean, in Somalia, they have written culture as well from through Islam and through Arabic. The letter that Farah wrote was in Arabic at the beginning. And so, I mean, I think it maybe has more of a kind of colonial force to it in other contexts. But Somali is interesting as well because the Somali language didn't receive an orthography until 1972. An official orthography, and so the oral culture really thrived in ways that it didn't in other places, and so written culture wasn't kind of imposed in the same way, and so I think it doesn't, in the Somali context at least, because of Arabic and Islam, and because the oral culture really kind of continued to thrive for so long, I don't think it has the same kind of colonial value, yeah.
Hi, Peter.
Hi.
Thanks for a really interesting talk. You mentioned near the end that phrase of Derrida's, the founding violence. And one of the founding violences that one would note in a field like law and literature is the very idea that there is any such thing as the law in the first place. Mm-hmm. I'm talking about, you know, sort of global society, multiple cultures. The idea that the very idea of the law is the same culture to culture is itself an abstraction. It's kind of a founding idea that allows us to have a discussion about law in different cultures, even though the law might mean different things. And in Africa, for example, you know, where there's, I've heard African scholars say that there's not one Africa, there are several, mm-hmm. multiple Africas. I've had friends of mine who are from African nations say that there isn't one nation, there are many within the same nation. And thinking about Somalia now, are there multiple conceptions of even the law and orature and different paradigms that make even the discussion of law or legalities in Somalia, poetic or legislative, what have you, somewhat in dispute? Now, do you find these kinds of microcosmic differences inscribed even into Somalian culture itself and their conception of law?
Thank you. Yeah, that's a great question. Somalia is a really interesting example because the Somalis form one of the largest homogenous ethnic blocs in Africa, taking in Djibouti, all of Somalia, the Ogaden region of that huge Ogaden region, and then the northern frontier district in Kenya. And so, and they've been described as very kind of xenophobic and resistant to outside influence, which was one of the reasons that there was this effort to overthrow the transitional government because it was supported by the U.S. and by Ethiopia in particular, and it had been installed by them. And was it 2006? So there's kind of more homogeneity and more uniformity that I've found. Anyway, there's not a huge amount of research on this, but from what I've found, there's more uniformity in these discussions, in oratory, in these practices, in the conceptions of the law than you would expect or see in other countries where you have kind of different ethnicities, different traditions functioning together. There is, of course, a difference between, you see differences in terms of the way law is conceptualized in these oral forms, and then the way law is conceptualized and practiced in Islam. So you have Sharia law, and then, of course, you have the complication of having had French, Italian, and English colonizers who all sort of instituted legal systems as well, and then periods of emergency law, which is a whole sort of another legal paradigm that changes things. So in terms of the orator, I think there's probably more uniformity than there is in other places throughout Somalia, but then you do have these other legal systems kind of piled on top of that. So.
I don't know if you've... I'm going to bring up a novel that I think most people know of in African literature, and that's Things Fall Apart. Uh-huh. When you're talking about law and literature and how performances... in Africa are often performances of the law or customary law, or whatever you might call it. I wondered if you could, for students and others who've read Probably Things Fall Apart, how do you see that, or do you see that as a commentary, the novel itself, and then also the performances within the novel on the law within the Igbo society, mm-hmm. or that those particular villages?
Thank you. I'll say first, there's a really interesting article, one of the few kind of earlier pieces on law and literature in Africa by Ravit Reichman on Things Fall Apart and law. And she offers this really interesting reading of the ending of the novel, where you have the district commissioner who comes in and finds Okonkwo's body and cuts it down and thinks, oh, this will form a really interesting part of my memoir on the suppression of the tribes of the Lower Niger. Is that right? The pacification, of the tribes of the Lower Niger. And he said, oh, this will be a great chapter. And then, oh, maybe an interesting paragraph, at least a footnote. This whole sort of epic tragedy in a footnote. But she reads this in the context of colonial law, at least, and how and district commissioners were sort of low-level magistrates who had, were sort of judges who'd see kind of minor cases. And they had this habit of writing their memoirs, and there's this whole tradition of judges in colonial India as well as in colonial Africa writing their memoirs about the different cases that they were involved in. So it's a really interesting reading of that novel, and I think it's in the journal Ariel Review of International English Literature, and I think it was 2004. But she doesn't talk about the oral law at all, and I think again it's not explicit. But I think it is there in the way that the different rituals, where they wear the masks and sort of perform the deity rituals and the spirits and then the many proverbs and things like that. I mean, there are sort of these things have sort of ordering and normative function in those societies, and I think it would be possible to read those things in terms of law, to sort of look at those traditions and look at the ways in which. Sort of Nigerian Igbo cosmology is simultaneously religious, and legal, right? And sort of offering the sort of governing function. I think that's part of what falls apart, right? Is the sort of order of the society, the sense of normativity, of structure that's reinforced by these kind of beliefs that are performed through those different rituals and expressed through those different proverbs and things. So.
So the novel, your novel, the trilogy, is uh-huh. written in English?
It is, yeah.
So who are the audiences? And then what are the implications or consequences from that?
Yeah, thank you. No, that's an excellent question. And when I've talked about Farah, this question comes up a lot. Farah said of this trilogy, as I quoted part of his statement, that he said something to the effect that when I write, I'm trying to counter the propagandistic and sort of single-minded discourses of the general, and what he sort of puts out there is the unchallengeable truth to the world. And so I think there was a sense that this is directed at an international audience, where Barre, as a dictator, as a general, is trying to portray himself to the rest of the world, to the international community, as the legitimate ruler. I have control here. Everything is fine. We didn't just execute those 10 sheikhs, everything which happened and comes up in the novel. And so, the Barre's publicity machine worked hard to sort of make him appear legitimate to the rest of the world. And this has happened with a lot of African dictators when, the West and the U.S. supports a certain leader without really knowing that, behind the scenes, there are all kinds of human rights violations going on. And so I think Farah, in part of his, his audience was an international audience, an English-speaking audience, who was hearing from Barre on the one hand, but Farah wanted to say, no, this is a different perspective. There's more going on than you know. And it's interesting that we never actually see the dictator in the novels. It's always the other characters. They're talking about the dictator. We sort of feel his sort of powerful presence, right? But the dictator is taken out of the center of the narrative, whereas most dictators want to be at the center, right? And so So I think it was all part of this sort of counter propaganda, partly that, you know. And I don't mean to say that they're kind of purely political, because they are very sort of artful and, you know, beautifully crafted novels. But again, I think that was kind of part of, you know, if eloquence and oratory is part of, you know, resisting that single-minded dictation culture. I think that's an important part of it. So I think, you know, I don't know if that answers your question, but I think that was part of it at the very least, yeah. So.
This is kind of a specific question about the novel, but I'm actually looking for you to maybe give a broader answer.
Okay.
I'm thinking about Closed Sesame. You have Dirye, who's sort of representative of this older generation who's very much embedded in oral culture and orature, who has these frequent conversations primarily with his son, who he's the lawyer, right?
Teaches constitutional law.
He teaches constitutional law, and they have these frequent, I would even maybe call them legal arguments, right, about the lex talionis, right, and the use of violence to resist the oppression of the dictator. So I wonder if you could say a couple of things about the way in which you see these different forms or traditions of law, the customary or traditional Islamic, the Western, the colonially imposed law, how you see these things sort of interacting or arriving at some kind of judgment in the post-colonial environment in Africa?
Yeah, thank you. That's kind of a big question. all of those laws coming together. But I will say, you know, some people have said Okot Batek, for example, in his poetry, where he really draws heavily on the oral traditions, sort of romanticizes tradition, right? And is, you know, is kind of counterposing tradition to modernity and saying we need to sort of return to that. I don't think he's doing that exactly, but that's been one of the critiques of his work. But I think it was Salman Gikandi said that there's no kind of clear distinction between tradition and modernity in Farah's works, that he's not at all interested in sort of promoting modernity over tradition or kind of maintaining that binary. He sort of wants to blur that. And so it's not the case where orature is the only, I mean, that's kind of what I've traced in here, and but that's not the only form of law, I think, that the narrative, the characters in the novel see as having kind of legitimacy. And in fact, it's interesting, in Somaliland, which is the northern part of Somalia, which has kind of declared its sovereignty, but it hasn't been recognized by anyone else, they have sort of successfully integrated kind of a modern parliament with these traditional legal procedures. They have a council of elders who serves on the parliament, and they incorporate these things. And so I think Farah, particularly in that third novel, there is this sense that these things can work together. And we see that, I think, in those discussions. Mursal is the name of the son who, is, they're having this discussion at the very beginning of the novel about the concept of lex talionis, which is sort of the eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth kind of form of law. And he's asking if Siad Barre's regime has any legitimacy as an Islamic state. And they're using these very sort of oral procedures, right? And he's kind of combining his training in constitutional law, I think, along with this sort of sensibility from orature to determine if they can legally depose the dictator. And it's interesting that it explores that in legal terms rather than just saying we need to take out the dictator. But he says, does the current state, does Barre's regime have any legitimacy as an Islamic state within traditional Islamic thought? And he decides ultimately that it doesn't, that it's illegal, and they therefore have a right to remove him. I don't think there's an easy answer to that, but I think that's part of Farah's point, that there isn't sort of an easy, we just need to go to tradition, or we need to sort of abandon tradition and go to sort of modern forms of law. There is sort of this recognized usefulness in all of these things kind of coming together to try to promote a more, I think, you know, just society, at least in contrast to Barre. I don't know if that answers your question, but that's an attempt.
I just wondered if you could compare the Somali case with the other countries you've looked at. Do we find this close link between law and oratory or orature in other places, or is this more of an exception, do you think?
It's not an exception. It's unique for a few reasons, as I tried to outline, where they've produced this the body of here literature, for example, and it's very this sort of very formalized legal procedure. I mean, the link is just so strong between law and orature. But in Nigeria, for example, there's been a fair amount of research. I have a good friend who's a public prosecutor in Nigeria who's doing research on this, collecting proverbs. Proverbs as this very sort of fundamental oral form expression of wisdom is not only used in traditional law, but is used in, you know, modern, you know, Western style courts as well, where he shared one example with me where he was arguing with a judge in court and he quoted a proverb and it kind of persuaded the judge. And so, and then in Uganda, you know, with Okot Batek's case, there's really interesting overlap there as well. Again, it's the research that I've found so far anyway hasn't sort of outlined it in the same detail that that Said Samader does, for example, with Somalia. But Okot does sort of insist that literally, that the African poet is a lawmaker, you know, expresses these legal ideas and legal norms. And he, as I said, he was also an ethnographer and has a really interesting book on the religion of the central Luo in northern Uganda and Kenya. And talks about many of the sort of speech acts, like curses and blessings that have the force of law. And these things show up in his poetry as well, where a curse is used as sort of a last resort in resolving a dispute to cast everything into this state of emergency. If a dispute isn't sort of being resolved, and in his poetry, there's this dispute between this housewife and her husband who's kind of rejected her and rejected society or rejected traditional society. And so she threatens to commit the wife's curse, which is sort of the worst curse imaginable. And it would bring spiritual punishment and trauma on the whole community. And that's sort of a last resort. If none of the other sort of measures work, then that curse could be committed. And suddenly all of the resources possible would be brought in to resolve the dispute. And so, I mean, there are differences, but there are, you know, important similarities and other oral traditions in other countries that have this kind of similar link between law and orature. So, yeah. Thank you.
A good place to end. Let's give Dr. Leman another round of applause.